Okay, so today I will answer a question asked by student Asma. She asked that why the frequency of light remain unchanged when light goes from one medium to other medium. Also, the second question was why the speed of light is greater in why the speed of red light is greater in a medium as compared to the blue light in the same medium. She also said that there are formulas, there are mathematical formulation. But we want to know the what is happening at the particle level. So I will try to explain that. So the phenomenon that is going when a light enters in a dielectric. That dielectric means in a slab. Okay, so let's consider a slab. Here light enters. Suppose this is the normal incidence of light on a glass slab. Okay. So what happens that it is made of this slab is made up of glass. Glass contains atoms which contains electrons which might be vibrating about their mean position. So, these all electrons have their own electric field which is E. Now this incident light wave has its own electric field and magnetic field. Okay, so this electric field will impose a this electric field will force the electrons to vibrate according to the resultant of these two electric fields. So what happens that the force situation arises where these electrons which were vibrating about their mean position are now vibrating according to these both electric fields. This induced electric this incoming electric field and the electric fields of their own. So this is a condition of forced oxidation, forced simple harmonic motion. Okay, so if we write the equation, it comes like this. Ex equal to minus q e naught. So this is the equation we can write for this situation. Let me verify. Okay, so if we solve this equation, how did we write this equation? This is the equation for forced simple harmonic motion. Okay, so this suppose that there was no light. So the simple the motion of electrons about their mean position was simple. There was no requirement of this term. But as we made the light incident on this glass slab, we have to include this. So if you solve this equation using some mathematical methods and all that, the solution comes like this: minus q e naught times m omega naught square minus omega square cos k z minus omega t. This type of solution comes out. Okay. Now here is a model is taken in account in which the center of nucleus is treated as positive charge, which is true. But the the center of mass of all the electrons is also taken at the center of the nucleus, at the center of the atom, that is at the nucleus, so that the net charge remains zero. Let me draw this. This is like this. This is the positive charge of the nucleus, and thus the center of mass of all the and the center of mass and charge of all the electrons is taken also here. So plus and minus gives zero. Now, due to this incident electric field, this atom is vibrating a little more. So there is a polarization induced in it, and hence this negative and positive centers are separated by a distance x. And you know that when two charges separate, there is a associated dipole moment and polarization. So if we write the equation for that, so polarization, you know, p equal to minus n times q into x. This is charges of all the electrons, and this is the displacement. Put it down that this incoming electric field induces a dipole moment in the material, corresponding to which polarization we can write as P = minus N times Q times s. Polarization is what? Dipole moment developed per unit volume is called polarization. Okay, so this is this. We can write this as n times q. Okay, this we can write as. Okay, so I will modify it a little bit. Put some value, put all the values of x and all that, and you will get n times q square over y m omega naught square minus omega square times e. Okay, so this is chi. Okay, chi is what? The electrical susceptibility of material. So you might have noted till now that all this matter of refractive index is just the polarization matter. Okay, so if you understand what is polarization, what is dipole moment and all that, then you can easily visualize what is the refractive index. Okay, so this is that, and if you solve this, what you will get is, okay, so now I will expand it a little bit. You know that epsilon equal to epsilon plus chi. This is permittivity of free space, permittivity of material plus this chi, electrical susceptibility. We take ratio 1 plus chi over by epsilon naught. Okay, now this term epsilon upon epsilon naught is known as the square root of this term is known as the square of refractive index in wave theory. If you study the wave theory, you will get to know that this term is equal to n square, means square of the refractive index. Okay, so 1 plus put the value of chi from here, this the only change will be epsilon naught will appear here. Okay, so do that. N minus q square divided by m epsilon naught omega naught square minus omega square. Okay, now take omega naught square common from this bracket, and you will get n square over 1 plus n times q square divided by m epsilon naught omega naught square 1 minus omega square upon omega naught square. You will take this bracket to the numerator with a inverse on its head, and you will get a binomial expansion of this term, 1 plus 1 minus 1 minus x to the power minus 1, 1 plus nx plus n, all that. So what you will get finally, I am writing that n square equal to 1 plus n q square divided by m epsilon naught omega naught square plus some constant upon other constant times omega naught to the power 4 into 1 upon lambda naught square. So this is what we get here. We get omega square term. Okay, omega square. Now you note that all this in this final formula, the refractive index is equal to all this term. That in this final formula of refractive index, our term appears in the second term is omega square, the square of frequency of the wave divided by lambda naught, means wavelength squared. Okay, so this is saying us that if you increase the frequency of any wave, the refractive index corresponding to that wave is going to increase. Okay, so you know that red light has the lowest frequency and blue light has the highest frequency. So red light will have the lowest wavelength, and this blue light will have the highest wavelength. Blue light will have the high refractive index. Okay, so try not to look from this formula, and try to imagine it in the terms of polarization. So consider the blue light, okay, which has the lower wavelength and higher frequency. Higher frequency means higher energy of that wave. Higher energy of that wave means higher the polarization of the material, and hence at the refractive index. So try to study the refractive index in terms of polarization and simple harmonic motion and all that, and you will get the required answer. So this is first term. This is first part. Sorry, this is not term. This is first part of your question. I will move to the second part. By the speed of red light is greater than the speed of blue light in any medium. I'm going to show that the speed of red light is greater in any medium as compared to blue light or any other light which has the wavelength or frequency. Which has the frequency lower than the red light. Okay, so here is that. So we have noticed that from here, n square equal to epsilon over epsilon naught. So n equal to under root of epsilon over epsilon naught. Now we also knew that from Maxwell's theory of electromagnetic waves, he had derived a beautiful relation which he showed that the speed with which the electromagnetic waves propagate is equal to 3 into 10 raised to the power 8. What formula did he use? He used this formula. Okay, so in terms of this, we will use this. Put epsilon from here and you will get n epsilon naught mu. Now you see that the higher the refractive index, lower the velocity of that light in a medium. So we noted down that the refractive index corresponding to red light is less than refractive index corresponding to blue light. So if we see it from here, then we can note that the speed of red light will be greater than the speed of blue light. Okay, again, don't see it from the formula, see it from, try to visualize it from the polarization point, angle of, polarization point of view. See, if a particular wavelength, a particular light has lower wavelength, means it has higher frequency, it has higher energy, and higher energy means it will induce more polarization, and hence there will be more deviation or more bending of light. Okay, so this is that. Now this is the first part of a question, why the red light has higher speed as compared to the blue light. Okay, so this is that. Now I will show you application of this concept in a prism. How can we use this concept in a prism? Okay, why we see the red light at the top of the prism and violet or blue light at the bottom of the prism? We will understand from a demonstration. I have this prism and the source of light is electric bulb. I have here this wall which I am using as a screen. You can see that after passing through this prism is getting separated into 7 colors. You can see very clearly the extreme colors which are red and violet. So the red light suffers less deviation as compared to the violet light, since it has a lesser refractive index as compared to the violet light. So the speed of red light in this prism, in this glass, is more than the speed of violet light. So it has a lesser time to interact with the electrons and other things of this material. So it suffers lesser deviation as compared to the violet light. Now this is another example of how refractive index and speed of light can be visualized. So using this straw model, a very easy demonstration can be shown for the purpose that if you increase the frequency of any wave, the velocity of that wave will increase. So I have this model in which I have used straws and some transparent tape to stick them together. Now I will hold it from the one end and will try to twist it so that the number of waves passing from a given point will increase. So we know that what is frequency? Frequency is the number of waves passing from a given point in a second. So here I will here I am giving it some twist so that number of waves passing from a given point will increase. So this portion, this is the maximum displacement of any wave, which is called amplitude. This is the minimum displacement, this is maximum, and so on. So this is like this. Now if I give a little jerk to it, then you see what happens. Disturbance goes from this side to that side and returns from that side to this side. See it again. Now notice the velocity of the wave notice the velocity through which the disturbance is going from this side to that side. Now I will reduce the frequency of wave by reducing the number of twists I have given. So you can see the how many number of waves are there? 1 and 2. There are only 2 waves present in this model. Now I will give the same jump to it, and you see the speed of disturbance will decrease. So as you can see, the disturbance now is taking some longer time to travel from this end to that end, and the same time to return from that end to this end. So in this case, the frequency is only 2. Since only 2 waves are passing from that point, this point to that point. Now let me increase the frequency. Now I have increased the frequency very much. So this is 1 wave, 2 wave, 3 wave, 4 wave, 5 wave. So this is more from the case 1. So now I will give a strong little jerk to it, and you will see what happens. The wave, the disturbance quickly propagates from this end to the other end and comes back. So this is the case. And now you have understood that when you increase the frequency of any wave, the velocity of that wave in that medium will increase in the same proportion. This is a very easy demonstration you can do at home by using some straws, which are very, very easily available in the market, and some transparent tape. Next part of the question is why the frequency of light remains unchanged. Okay, so this is the main part, and this is the part which is also most interesting. So let me derive that. Okay, so consider this a glass slab. Okay, in a glass slab, suppose the light is incident from this side, from the bottom side, and goes in some manner in this glass slab. Let's consider it in this manner. Now this is a Gaussian pillbox. Okay, this we have considered a cylinder on the interface of two media, the air and the glass. Okay, why we have done that? Because we will derive the continuity condition for electric and magnetic fields at this interface. Okay, since we knew that the light is going from air to glass, so the electric and magnetic field associated with that light wave should remain conserved or should be continuous. Okay, otherwise the laws of physics would fail. Okay, so let us do that. We know that the divergence of B equal to 0. Okay, so this is surface 1, this is surface 2, and this is surface 3, the curved surface, surface 3. We will integrate this as a volume integral over these three surfaces. So let us do that. Divergence of B, dV, S1, S2, S3. So this gives us what? Close integral S1, BdA, plus S2, BdA, BdA. How did I write this? This is using Green's theorem. You might have studied in the vector calculus. There is a theorem called Green's theorem, where the okay. So this is a theorem called Green's theorem, which relates the volume integral to the surface integral. Okay. So we have done it here. Now note that note that around this surface S3, the curved surface, the value of this integral is going to be 0. Why? Why is that going to happen? Because I have shown the cylinder to be large, but in fact it is not. It's a very very thin cylinder, thin than a coin. So if we take L tends to 0, and L means the length of the cylinder or height of the cylinder. If we tend the length to 0, then this integral would vanish. We are left with only these two integrals, and these two integrals give V n equal to B2n. Means the normal component of magnetic field at the interface should be equal. B1n1 V2n. And V1n is in this direction and B2n is in the upper direction. So this is that. Now in a similar manner, we will do it for this Maxwell's this equation. This is I guess third equation of Maxwell. Okay, so we will do the same for this. Now in the case of a pillbox, we will consider a loop at the interface of two media. Suppose this is medium 1, this is medium 2, and we have considered this a rectangular loop. Okay, we will apply this here to here to here to here. This line integral, this is a this we will consider, we will surface integrate this whole term, and we will convert this into a line integral. Okay, since we have a loop, so we should integrate this in a linear manner. Okay, so we will use Stokes' theorem, which relates the surface integral to the line integral. And if we do that, this part and this part are going to cancel, because the length of all these two parts, similar to this case, is very small, very very small. So we can tend it to zero, and hence we are left with only two terms, this one and this one. And what we get? We get E1t equal to E2t. Means the tangential component of electric field at the interface should be continuous, and the normal component of magnetic field should be continuous. So when light is going from one medium to another medium, the normal component of magnetic field and tangential component of electric field should be continuous at the interface. This is what we should remember. Okay, so we are going to explain why the frequency of light remains unchanged. So we have derived the continuity conditions for electric and magnetic fields. Now consider this is the interface, okay, and light ray is going from this medium to from medium 1 to medium 2, and this is the interface. This is incident wave, this is refracted wave, and this is transmitted wave, or reflected wave you may say. Now consider the axis system as follows. X axis this side, Y axis this side, and Z axis to the out of plane. Okay, so now if we write the equation for electric field, it would be as follows. E equal to E naught exponent iota k vector dot r vector minus omega t. This is like this. Okay, now we will write it for all the three waves. This is E1, E2 and E3. E1 means the electric field associated with this wave is E1, the electric field associated with this wave is E3, and same for this. Now we will write the this in expanded form for all these three, E1, E2 and E3. Okay, so let me write that E1, E2 and E3. E01, E02 and E03. Okay, exponent iota I am taking as common here. So this iota k kx x k y y plus k z z minus omega t. Okay, you may add a suffix to it, k 1x. So this is for one wave. Sorry, this is for wave number one. This incident wave. Similarly, you can write for this exponent iota common k 2x x plus k 2y y 1 plus k 2z z minus omega t. Okay, and similarly you can write for it. Now at the x equal to 0, this point is x equal to 0, so at this point these now we address all these three equations at x equal to 0. So we have to put x equal to 0 in this all these equations so that the term containing x will vanish. What we are left with is this. So this is that, this is this. Now let me write it in a good manner. So this is what we are left with, iota iota. Iota, iota, E not 1, E not 2, E 1 बराबर, E 2 बराबर, this is E to the power and this is also E to the power. Okay, now see that we have written this all these equations for x equal to 0. Similarly for E 3, I have not written that, you can do that. So at x equal to 0, this is the picture. Now for all for E1, E2 and E3, the electric field for all the component of electric field to be equal, it is necessary that the exponent term should be equal. And how will they equal? The coefficient of the coordinates appearing in all these three equations should be equal, means k1y equal to k1z, k2y equal to k2z and k3y equal to k3z. This is the first condition, k1y barabar k1z, k2y barabar k2z. Okay, also this is 1, this is 2. The term containing this t, this omega should be equal, means omega 1 equal to omega 2 equal to omega 3. Omega is nothing but the frequency of the wave. Okay, so the frequency of wave 1, incident wave, equal to frequency of refracted wave equal to frequency of transmitted wave. So the frequency of all the three waves are equal. This is what we have shown from the continuity conditions. From how we have shown this? By imposing the continuity condition at the interface. Okay, so this is how we show that the frequency of light remains unchanged on going from one medium to another. This is the explanation of your question. I hope I could have explained what you have asked.